Good evening, everyone. I'm Mary Bounds and I'm the Senior Vice Principal at the University of Edinburgh. So welcome to this public lecture, which marks 10 years of being a Fairtrade University. And this followed a student vote in 2003. And I'm pleased that the University of Edinburgh was the very first university in Scotland to gain Fairtrade University status. And many others have now followed suit. And fair trade is about improving livelihoods for some of the poorest people in the world. So it's an incredibly important issue to learn about and to support. Tackling the topic of fairness in global trade is one element of Edinburgh's approach to educating students to become the global citizens of tomorrow. And you will hear more about this from our current student, Vice President of Services, Kirsty, later. As Scotland also celebrates the first anniversary of becoming a fair trade nation today, we're very pleased that the Minister, Humza Yousaf MSP, who's the Minister for External Affairs and International Development, will be in our midst any minute, and will update us on that initiative shortly. Our students and staff across the university have made continuously improving commitments in terms of procuring and selling fair trade products. They hold awareness raising events, carry out research, and that includes working within the framework where we have a fair trade academic network. They forge links with businesses, the third sector, and the government, and collaborate on making trade fairer. This lecture marks 10 years of such initiatives, building on the early fair trade movement, which was initiated by students, one of whom is now a professor here, Professor Michael Northcote, a member of the Sustainability and Environmental Advisory Group that I chair. But such an anniversary is also a time to take stock, reflect on what we've done and consider what next steps may be needed to build on existing work to reduce injustices and inequalities in international business, and to link people here with the producers of our food and other products, all learning to solve global challenges together. You're all invited to engage in this process. You'll see on your seats a little piece of paper. Well, it's actually quite a big piece of paper. And you're invited to write your thoughts on that about what you think next for fair trade. So what are your thoughts about what should happen next in the fair trade area? And write that on the triangles that you see on your seats. And they're going to be made into a bunting, which will be displayed at other events. And we will take your ideas into account in planning the university's future strategy on fair trade. So this is your chance to engage and help shape the future. Now I'd like to introduce our keynote speaker, Paul Chandler. Paul Chandler was chief executive of Traidcraft from 2001 to 2013. Traidcraft is one of the world's leading fair trade specialists, uniquely combining a significant trading company with the work of an international development charity. And it also engages in advocacy and campaigning work in the wider fields of promoting responsible business practices. He's currently working to promote ethics in the financial sector, reflecting his early career at Barclays Bank, as well as his background in fair trade. Paul is a director of Shared Interest, the Fair Trade Financial Organisation, Engage Mutual Assurance, and the William Leach Foundation. He's also a fellow of St Chad's College at Durham University and chair of the council at Durham Cathedral, and a trustee of the County Durham Community Foundation. However, before I hand over to Paul, we're just going to show you a video that's just been made.
Thank you. My name's Liz Cooper and I am a research and policy manager at the university focusing on fair trade. Before working at the University of Edinburgh, I worked in Senegal and India for a total of 4 years on fair trade projects on the ground. So I've seen the difference a small increase in price for us can make to farmers and producers of the things we consume in developing countries.
10 years ago, students voted that the Students' Association and University should become fair trade. We've had things like Fairtrade Cafe, we celebrate Fairtrade Fortnight every year, all of our teas and coffees are Fairtrade, and it's something which the university heavily pushes as well. I think the majority of students know what Fairtrade is and can tell you something about it, but what we still need to expand on is the understanding of Fairtrade as a concept.
Fair trade is actually a very complex phenomenon, it's a very complex idea. We can just see that a product has fair trade stamped on it and think, oh well, we do our bit by buying it. But in fact, there's a lot of questions to be involved about what fairness means. Fairness for whom? Fairness in what terms? And if what's fair for one person is less fair for another, how are we to decide whose fairness we should give priority to? So there are a host of practical research questions, plus ethical questions, that we need to be engaged in. And we don't claim that we're going to come up with the answers, so we engage with the students and the public also in thinking through these various questions.
It can be the difference between farmers being in debt or not being in debt, the difference between being able to send a child to school or not, or paying for your healthcare or not. So this is why we really need to continue to work on trying to make trade fairer across the world.
Well, it's wonderful to be here this evening to celebrate some real success stories. It's fantastic to mark the 10th anniversary of Edinburgh becoming a fair trade university. And I do know from conversations I've had with people at the Fair Trade Foundation just how impressed they've been by the range of activities the university has undertaken over the years. And it's gone well beyond the level of engagement in most of the other 170 fair trade universities and higher education institutions. So you are among the first, but you're still leading the way in terms of your commitment to supporting fair trade. And I know we're also recognising this week the 10th anniversary of Edinburgh as a fair trade city and the first anniversary of Scotland as a fair trade nation. And all of this is just testimony to the efforts and enthusiasm of the Scottish Fair Trade Forum, but of activists, supporters, world shops up and down the country who've worked tirelessly over many, many years to promote fair trade around Scotland. And it's great to celebrate those achievements. Because there's no doubt in my mind that Scotland has played a very significant part in the spectacular growth of fair trade in the UK over the past 10 years or so. From being an also-ran country, whilst fair trade was much more developed in Netherlands, in Germany and Switzerland, the UK has in the last 10 years become the largest and most dynamic fair trade market in the world. And it now accounts for something like a third of all fair trade sales in the world. But for me, it was actually the Make Poverty History March in this very city at the time of the 2005 G8 summit that was actually a real turning point. I was here taking that photo, and I just could tell from my role at Traidcraft how it triggered a new level of engagement from the business sector with the idea of fair trade. Suddenly, everyone was talking about trade justice and what could companies do to get involved and show their support. And that process fueled the development of a huge variety of new fair trade products. And in just a couple of years, the number of products carrying the fair trade mark rose from under 100, most of them from Traidcraft, to 4,500 that we have today from a huge range of different companies and brands, as well as from the dedicated fair trade organisations. And that increased availability and growth in range has been the essential underpinning of the amazing and spectacular growth we've seen in fair trade sales volumes. Just want to take a moment to look at the actual scale of that growth. So this is a chart showing the value of fair trade sales in the UK since 2002. Not many businesses could actually point to that sort of exponential growth curve. And the pattern you'll notice has just continued unaffected by the onset of the economic recession, at a time when you might have expected consumers to be economising, thinking, well, I'd better not prioritise that, I need to save money for myself. The latest figures, which is the blue column on the right-hand end there, which I haven't got the breakdown of the figures by product yet, But the latest figures released yesterday by the Fairtrade Foundation show that last year, £1.78 billion of Fairtrade sales were achieved in the UK. And that's a 14% year-on-year increase. And it means that we're selling about 35 times more Fairtrade goods now than we were just 10 years ago. Last year, because I haven't got this year's 2013 figures, but in 2012, a quarter of all the roast and ground coffee sold in Britain carried the Fairtrade mark. One in three bananas that are eaten are Fairtrade. 44% of all the bagged consumer sugar in the UK in 2012 carried the Fairtrade mark. It's probably higher now. Of the top four chocolate confectionery brands, three carry the Fairtrade mark. That's Dairy Milk, Kit Kat and Maltesers. These are significant proportions of really important grocery sectors. Fairtrade can no longer be dismissed as a minority interest, as an irrelevant thing that development activists and sort of former hippies might be interested in. It's actually a mainstream commercial option. It's achieving significant market impact. So it is a remarkable story that we're noting this evening. But before we go any further, we should pause and just acknowledge a few things which put this apparent story of unbridled success into a bit more realistic perspective. Firstly, for all of the growth and the impressive figures that these look like, Fairtrade still accounts for only a tiny proportion of what could be sold as Fairtrade products, potentially. We're still a couple of percent, even in the commodities which already are eligible for a Fairtrade mark. It's much more visible than that those figures might suggest, because the brands and the retailers really want to promote it because they can see the consumer benefits, saying we're really behind fair trade. The reality, it's still just the tip of the potential iceberg that we could achieve. And secondly, for all of the impact that we've been able to have on producers, and the Fairtrade Foundation estimates that it's about 1.5 million producers and their families, so probably 7 million people directly benefiting from fair trade today. That's great, but it's only a scratch on the surface of the challenge of global poverty. As we all know, the scandal of 2.5 billion people, one in three humans alive today, living below the World Bank's $2 a day absolute poverty line, that is just a scandal. And fair trade's hardly making a dent on those figures. And despite the occasional claims of enthusiastic supporters of Fairtrade who seem to think that it will deliver every single good cause you could think of, Fairtrade isn't actually going to be the single silver bullet solution that is going to overcome the scandal of 2.5 billion people in that sort of poverty. But actually, does it make any real difference at all? Or is it just a marketing ploy, as you hear people saying? Or even some critics claim that Fairtrade is counterproductive and potentially damaging to the economic growth that's fundamental to the fight against poverty. Well, over the next few minutes, I'm going to try and respond to some of the most common critiques of fair trade, and also to bring the reality of fair trade to life by presenting a number of case studies, three case studies, of the impact of fair trade relationships, all of which are fair trade producer groups that I have visited firsthand and seen for myself, but also all of which have been subject to external research and independent scrutiny to really see that these aren't just anecdotes, but there's some real reality to the impact that's been had. So that's to come in a few moments. But first, just look at the grounds on which fair trade is attacked and some of the immediate responses we can make to that. I think there are three main types of critique that are made. First of all, there's the free market economist school of thought, and being in Scotland, we have to represent that with Adam Smith, of course. Many academic economists, very wedded to the free market theories, will argue that by keeping unviable agricultural commodity producers in business, fair trade's distorting the market efficiency, that if it wasn't for fair trade, these producers would be investing in more productive technologies, and or if that, they couldn't do that, their resources would be reallocated into more productive, economically viable areas of the economy. And in the long term, those economists would argue that will create more wealth and that will lift more people out of poverty. Now, within the limits of that theoretical economic model, the case appears to be true. Anything that distorts the operation of free markets isn't going to be the most efficient way of creating economic growth. But I have to say that to the ordinary person in the street, recent experience of, let's say, the financial services market, doesn't actually suggest that markets left to their own devices can be relied on always to deliver the greatest social or economic good. And of course, maximising wealth creation, which is the fundamental argument that the economists are putting forward, actually doesn't necessarily lead to the relief of poverty unless you consider wealth distribution at the same time. And all around the world, what we see today and consistently over recent decades is inequality growing at the same time as the world economy is growing. So although some people get more job opportunities, we aren't seeing economic growth really meeting the needs of the poorest people, the most marginalised producer groups around the world. Free market advocates also tend to ignore the human implications of this transfer reallocation of resources that they're so fond of. Poor producers just don't have the capital or the knowledge to switch from growing coffee or growing sugarcane to manufacturing widgets. So any transition as their existing sort of field of endeavour is switched out of actually involves acute poverty, forced migration, often into the slums of big towns, and huge undesirable social impacts. The end of wealth maximisation may be a good one, but I don't actually believe the way free markets operate will necessarily always deliver that, and certainly those ends don't always justify the means and the human pain that can be caused. And actually, as I hope my case studies are going to illustrate, far from keeping producers trapped in old technologies and being inefficient, my experience of fair trade, when done properly, is that it does provide the wherewithal and the encouragement that actually helps producers to do that sort of investment and diversification that the free market theorists would like to see. And I have to say, I've always found it very frustrating when talking to many of these economists, and some of them can be just as full of emotion as fair trade supporters from their own perspective. They just don't recognise that actually fair trade is working within market mechanisms. We are actually a free market approach where consumers are making their choices, and fair trade movement is harnessing the power of consumer choice to encourage businesses to operate in different things. That is a free market solution, actually. Additional money flows to producers only because consumers are choosing to make it do so by paying a bit more for a product or by switching their loyalty to brands and retailers that they believe are supporting fair trade. And I suspect that what's at the heart of the economists' hostility to fair trade is the fact that it demonstrates that consumers don't all make purchasing decisions based purely on maximising their individual financial benefit. That's the fundamental premise of most economic sort of theories and models of supply and demand and how that works. In fact, many people up and down the country are showing very visibly that they are prepared to pay a bit more because they care about the conditions of the producers behind the products that they're buying and using. And that is actually a perfectly reasonable economic choice for those consumers to make. Ethical values have a real monetary value, as well as any intrinsic material benefits that are gained. But that sort of understanding of how humans work, I don't believe is properly incorporated into much economic thinking about rational consumer behaviour. A second strand of criticism comes from the other end of the spectrum, from those development enthusiasts who are innately suspicious of markets and big companies, who feel that fair trade sold its soul to the devil by getting involved with the big supermarkets and international food companies. For those who've campaigned against Nestlé, it seems a contradiction in terms that Nestlé could do a fair trade product. And again, you can understand, and there is some justice in those criticisms of fair trade and its engagement with big companies. And we certainly need to be very realistic and tread very carefully, recognising that the motivation of these large companies in entering fair trade is very different from the motivation of the early dedicated pioneers, the Traidcrafts and equal exchanges of this world. And the involvement of these big companies will disappear as quickly as consumer demand disappears, if it does. They're not there for the long term. They're there while consumers are saying that's what they want. And I fear that as big companies get more and more dominant within the world of fair trade, so they will very naturally start pushing for dilution of standards to make it easier for them to engage in fair trade or to make better profits whilst engaging in fair trade. So these are real risks. But if we're serious about tackling the global poverty challenge, those billions of people who are in need, rather than just wanting to create an ethically pure niche so a few holy consumers can have products that they know the producers have been well treated for, if we want to get beyond that and really make an impact on world poverty, well, frankly, we're not going to be able to do it without working with the big food companies, the big retailers. They've got scale, expertise, access to market that we could not achieve in any other way. The third strand of criticism comes from people who just don't believe fair trade really works at all, that it is just a marketing ploy, and you'll get journalists going out increasingly to try and visit some fair trade producers, and then they're shocked when they go to a producer group and they find these people are poor. I expected fair trade producers to be rich because of all the extra money that we're paying them through fair trade. And then they claim that consumers are being misled, that it's all a fraudulent sort of conjuring trick, smoke and mirrors of the marketing men. Well, actually, I think it's very good that we do have investigative journalists going out with a critical eye to look at what's going on in fair trade supply chains. That sort of scrutiny of any business's supply chains is really important if we're going to keep companies, whether they're a fair trade organisation or a big multinational, we're going to keep them focused on doing things right. But when you actually look at the supposed revelations of poor fair trade practices, what they usually reflect is simply the fact that fair trade does indeed work with poor people. That's the whole point of the exercise. If they were already okay and rich and had all the resources they needed, well then we wouldn't need to be trying to prioritise giving a share of the market to those people. Because fair trade isn't about helping us to feel good about only buying from people who are well off. It's about being a tool for sustainable development. And in most of the cases that journalists and others have claimed to expose and be shocked by, when you look at the detail of it, actually the sad fact is that fair trade only accounts for a very small proportion of what they actually produce, because the market isn't big enough for them to sell everything on fair trade terms. So they're getting a bit of benefit on that chunk of their business that is fair trade related, but it's not actually enough to transform their livelihoods instantly. So it's not surprising that they haven't all worked their way out of poverty yet. But let's try and bring this a bit more to life by talking about some real sort of examples, looking at my three case studies and at the evidence they provide for how fair trade works in practice. When Traidcraft started out back in the 1970s, our most iconic products, as some of you will sort of even recognise this one of our first ever catalogues, most iconic products were jute products, hanging baskets, hammocks, things like that. And they were made by craftswomen in Bangladesh. And this is a lady called Firoza, who actually was one of the very original producers who supplied Traidcraft. And quite early on in my time, when I joined Traidcraft back in 2001, I went out to Bangladesh. And I wanted to go to the village where Firoza worked to see, well, here's one of the longest case studies we could see. What difference has it made trading with Traidcraft for 25 years, as it then was? I have to tell you, my first impression was one of huge disappointment. The village was still very poor. There was no running water, there was no electricity, it was very much tin roofs and mud walls. The villagers were clearly living on a subsistence basis. So what was this all about? What had I joined up to? Why was it not better than that after several decades of trading with Traidcraft and other fair trade organisations? So I put that question to some of the women in the village. Firoza sadly died just a few months earlier. But through the translator, these ladies agreed that actually, yeah, they were still quite poor. They did depend on subsistence agriculture, growing rice in the fields around them and the like. And they pointed out to me that the craft work they did for Traidcraft was just a sort of a tiny bit of extra work that they could fit in the evenings or in the seasons when they weren't having to work quite as hard in the fields. It was a supplementary source of income, not their financial mainstay. So it was never going to provide for everything that they might want in order to be lifted out of poverty. But actually, that didn't mean that it wasn't making a crucial difference to their lives. Most of these women in this village, and actually it's quite a typical picture across the world of fair trade, had spent their extra income educating their children, seeing them through primary school, and then in some cases to secondary school, and even through to university. And as a result, these ladies are able to tell me that their children have gone on to better jobs than their parents would ever have been able to imagine for themselves. Some of those children had then come back as adults to the village in a more professional capacity. So I was able to meet Nargis, who's the lady with her back to us there, who was Feroza's daughter, and she had gone off, she'd been to university, she'd trained as a teacher, and she had opened a primary school in the village. So now all the villagers were able to have easy access to education for their children. And indeed, Feroza's granddaughter, who was about two at this time, would be benefiting from this long-term process that had been started by those fair trade bits of money that they've been able to spend, not on themselves, but on their children. And others of those women I was speaking to talked about how their children had gone off to Dakar, the capital city, or even gone overseas, and were now sending back money to provide for them in their old age, to build slightly better houses, but just to give them some security, sort of pension provision in a country where pensions just don't exist as a concept. So the impact on these women hadn't been dramatic or immediate, but actually over a generation, it has made a huge difference to the lives of people coming from that village. And too often in the world of development, we're looking for short-term solutions, largely because the big grants come from governmental institutions and the electoral cycle means we want results within 5 years, please, thank you very much. Actually, we sometimes have to take a much slower burn approach to development that's really going to be sustainable. So there's the children, the next generation. But you might just say, this is just a nice anecdotal illustration, my holiday snaps and conversations. But following my visit, we commissioned a PhD student at Durham University to go and spend 3 years studying these women and about 200 other fair trade craftswomen and comparing them with a control sample of 200 craftswomen who hadn't done fair trade sales but were doing similar products to sell in local markets. And as a result of her PhD studies, and she had a team of Bangladeshi students helping her to do the research, she found that actually the fair trade women were significantly more likely to be able to buy land, that they had the confidence to access healthcare, that they were proving to be more literate because they were using their literacy skills, and interestingly, they had the status in their own families to have a say as to whether their daughters, who their daughters should marry, something which in the Muslim societies part of Bangladesh, normally, the women weren't expected to have a say in, but they had a status because of the fair trade earnings they had brought into the family. They weren't super empowered modern women. Let's not sort of pretend that they weren't still poor women in some difficult cultural situations, but they and their community and their families had achieved greater well-being through fair trade. My second example is from Gujarat, and this is Karshan Chowdhury. He's a cotton farmer in a very arid area of northwestern India. And Traidcraft worked about 10 years ago with him and with 30 of his neighbours to establish the first ever fair trade certified cotton supply chain. And we also introduced organic cotton farming at the same time. After 4 years, we got Mott MacDonald, a management consultancy firm, to come in and do an independent assessment of what difference it had made. What they found was that actually overall income levels were about the same. You might think that isn't terribly spectacular. What had happened is that by going organic, the yields of cotton had gone down, and that was just about compensated for by the fair trade extra price and the organic premium that they'd got. But by going organic, they'd had to start rotating crops, because without fertilisers, you can't keep growing cotton year after year on the same foods. So actually what was then found was that though their income was the same, whereas in the past 90% had come from cotton, that was down to 65%. And that's a much more resilient place for a poor farmer to be, not dependent on the ups and downs of a single market. And then they said, but of course, they're not having to spend all this money on chemical fertilisers and pesticides, which actually can account for 40 or 50% of the cost of production in India. So the net incomes had actually increased by about 20 to 25% on average. And that income, together with the fair trade premium payments, had led to investment in drip irrigation systems, investment in tractors. This isn't people being trapped in unproductive techniques or in cash crops. They're beginning to diversify into new crops, new techniques, more efficient production methodologies. They also could see improved school facilities and provision of skills training for women as some of the fair trade premiums were spent on those bases. The initial group of 30 farmers that we worked with had grown in 4 years to 3,000 farmers. So that's people voting with their feet to say, I want a part of that action. And to everyone's astonishment, there was now evidence of reverse migration and the next generation deciding to come back from the slums of Mumbai to the fields because they could see there's a decent standard of living to be achieved now back on the land. It's a far cry from keeping farmers trapped in dependency and uneconomic activity. These farmers now sell to Marks and Spencer, and they're even beginning to talk about maybe we should buy the ginning factory, move up the value chain, begin to get more value. It's amazing, so when you go to a cotton ginning factory and just see it in masses there. But they're beginning to think entrepreneurially and how they can actually take themselves forward. My final case study doesn't actually relate to international fair trade as such. It's from a project that Traidcraft's development teams have been running, taking fair trade principles of how you organise farmers and then applying it in a local context to see how can this work in a local context. This is Bangladesh. And we worked with vegetable farmers and with duck farmers, rather nice picture of a duck farmer there, to help them sort of become more productive and to work better in their own local market. And the central heart of the project was forming self-help groups of 20 to 30 farmers, groups which could share knowledge, they could create resilience through savings clubs, like little mini credit unions, and just as a group being able to negotiate better with suppliers and with buyers of their products. They also found being part of a group meant that the local government agricultural officers, who do exist all around Bangladesh, they haven't got the time to go and speak to every individual farmer, but they could make the time to come and talk to a group of 30, and that could unlock access to grants or training and other advice. The other key principle that we used was finding how to get private sector supply chains to channel knowledge and expertise down to the farmer level. So we worked with agricultural input suppliers, working with some of the great big multinational sort of companies, encouraging them to provide better advice on how to use fertilisers effectively, which usually meant putting less fertiliser on. The farmer tends to think, just shovel on lots of sacks, and that's a huge cost, and it actually doesn't make your vegetables any more productive. It can be counterproductive. This not only helped the farmers grow better crops at a better price, but the suppliers themselves found they got a reputation for giving good advice, and so other people would start going to them, and they found it was good business for them, not just to sell whatever they could, but to offer a good service. So again, we used external consultants to assess the impact of this project, and they found that across the 5,000 farmers we've been organising, their income levels had risen by about 60% over a three-year period, whereas other farmers in the same area, which we used as our control sample, had seen incomes grow by about 20%. Inflation and normal growth had happened, but there's still a 40% differential there. And if you're scraping by on a living of absolute poverty, 40% makes a huge difference. So despite what sceptics and critics might say, fair trade, when properly undertaken, does have a direct impact on producers. It's less about paying a better price, but long-term relationships, giving the security to invest. It's the benefits of working as part of a group. It's about learning and knowledge transfer through a trading relationship. And it's about having the opportunity to make investments and to diversify. Fair trade's not perfect. It doesn't work equally well in every instance. It doesn't do everything that needs doing. But it does make a demonstrable difference. Now, I've given all my examples from the work of Traidcraft because clearly that's what I know best. And I do believe the style of engagement that the pioneers like Traidcraft, like Equal Exchange here in Edinburgh, Café Direct, Tropical Whole Foods, Liberation Foods, Divine Chocolate, and the sort of other fair trade players that the One World Shop here in Edinburgh will be sourcing their goods from, I think there is a qualitative difference in the style of relationships and the depth of impact and the length of relationship that's achieved that way. But it's fair to say that many similar benefits are still achieved through the mainstream companies' involvement in fair trade, and the fair trade mark and its auditing systems does ensure that's the case. But these direct impacts on producers may not even be the most important way in which fair trade is making a difference. I think there are two other indirect impacts of fair trade that are, in my view, at least equally significant. The first of these is the way that fair trade has just raised public awareness of global poverty and the importance of our own behaviours as consumers to sustainable improvement. Unlike any other campaigning activity, fair trade provides a daily reminder every time you make that cup of coffee or tea and use a fair trade product, or every time you go to the shops, you're reminded that your choices have a part to play in the fight against poverty, that you, as an individual, can make a difference to the lives of people elsewhere in the world. And Fairtrade's been particularly effective, I think, in engaging children and young people through work in schools. A sense of fairness is often innate in many young children, but this also promotes a recognition of responsible citizenship and the importance of being connected and understanding where things come from that we all use. And I think that's a really positive development for the way people feel about themselves and recognise that we're all part of a global community. And the second indirect impact comes as a result of that public awareness in the way that that has fuelled pressure for corporate social responsibility in businesses. There are very few big household name FTSE 100 companies now that don't produce a plethora of reports which would make you think that they were a development agency rather than a profitable company. And actually there's many good things they are doing that are reported on in these reports. I'm not trying to knock it entirely. They've been going into corporate social responsibility for a number of reasons. It manages their reputation risk. You don't want to have a Rana Plaza sort of disaster sort of influencing your brand image. It's about retaining and recruiting good staff. It's about improving your own knowledge and management of your supply chains. It's about forestalling governments coming in and regulating you, and like the supermarket adjudicator that Traidcraft campaigned for many years and that's now in place. So there are all sorts of reasons for going for the CSR, the corporate responsibility agenda. But the most crucial bit of the business case, the reason why they do it, is because it's what they know consumers, or many consumers, want to have. That consumer choice is what's driving corporate behaviour. And I think fair trade has been one of the most effective and visible incentives for those sorts of changes in companies that we've seen in our generation. Who would have thought 10 years ago that Nestlé would have to take Kit Kat fair trade? I debated at the Oxford Union with their chief executive. He said, "We will never do that in a million years." 5 years later, he did it. Not because he'd heard me arguing the case for fair trade, but because his managers in this country were saying, actually, Cadbury's have gone fair trade, we're going to lose out if we don't do the same. Competition in the marketplace, consumer-led market forces is creating change. So that's why supporting fair trade as a university, as a country, as a city, has been so important and remains very effective. So thank you to everyone here who's played a part in that story. But what about the future? My time, I'm very conscious, is limited, but I just want to conclude with some thoughts on where the fair trade agenda is going, the challenges and opportunities facing the movement, and how Scotland and Scottish institutions could have some particular parts to play. We're actually at a very crucial moment, I believe, in the life of the fair trade movement. The fair trade mark is governed by an organisation called Fairtrade International, based in Bonn, which sets the global standards for fair trade. And they've recently, just in the last few weeks, announced that, I believe, responding to pressure from some of the big companies, that they're moving away from the requirement that to have a mark on a product, everything that could be fairly traded in that product has to be. That's been the rule hitherto. Now they're saying, under the terms of the fair trade sourcing programme, as long as one ingredient is fair trade, you can still have a mark on it. So you could have chocolate with fair trade cocoa, but where the sugar, the nuts, the raisins weren't fairly traded and being claimed as fair trade. Now, if you're a producer of cocoa or cotton, some two key ingredients there, this probably is going to be good news for you. And if you're a fair trade labelling organisation, you will see the volume of your sales growing, as it's easier for chocolate companies to just get into fair trade cocoa or whatever. But it's less likely to be good news if you're a producer of a smaller ingredient, the nuts or the raisins, where until now, the companies have had to start looking at their supply chains to source from you as well. And it's going to be distinctly bad news, I fear, for some of the dedicated pioneer organisations, the Traidcrafts, the Divine Chocolates, who will remain true to their principles, but whose chocolate will then start looking a lot more expensive than something else which has also got a fair trade mark on it. Now, the new mark will say it's just the cocoa, but how many consumers will notice the difference or use that to discriminate? So there's a risk. And it has to be said, the Fairtrade Foundation in this country has recognised that it's got to move more slowly than is going to happen in other countries, because consumers could be misled and because the whole fair trade ecosystem could be adversely affected. So I hope that we may find ways of managing it better in the UK than elsewhere. But this development points to the key challenge about the future of fair trade. Is it going to be a gold standard, difficult to attain, but representing the best practice in sustainable development? Or is it going to try and be an easier standard to encourage more companies to get in and comply with an ethical standard? And we've seen with the Rainforest Alliance coming through, that's it's a less rigorous standard than fair trade. Companies have got into it as an alternative to going fair trade. So I think the gold standard has brought people into rainforest. And actually, even though I'm a fair trade advocate, rainforest does do a lot of good. We did some studies at Traidcraft, and we reckoned that although it was making less of a social impact than fair trade, it was making more impact than not having any sort of ethical labelling at all. But there's a strategic choice to be made. Do we stick at the top and draw others towards us by comparison, or do we get into a race to the bottom by just making it easier and easier to claim you're in fair trade? I think fair trade campaigners, fair trade cities, countries, universities, need to have a say in this debate in the UK before we let the genie out of the box and we find that we've done some unknown damage that we weren't expecting. I actually think we could make fair trade standards even more rigorous, even more effective, even more impactful. For example, when mainstream companies switch to fair trade, they usually, quite naturally, and it's perfectly reasonable, take their existing supply chains, where they're probably not being totally exploitative because of the reputation risks of doing that, and they make slight improvements to the benefits on offer. It's still good for the producers concerned. They will meet the minimum fair trade standards, but it's primarily helping people who've already got access to a market, not the most marginalised. It's not reaching out. I'd love to see a requirement that a big company needs to source a proportion of its fair trade ingredients from new marginalised producers in more difficult circumstances. How are we going to really incorporate living wage methodologies and fair trade standards? How can we look more at migrant and seasonal labourers in fair trade supply chains who often are quite difficult to monitor and tend to get overlooked? Can we really actively encourage the use of fair trade premiums to do the sort of diversification of markets and products that I've mentioned? These are all ways in which we could further increase the impact of fair trade. Again, these farmers in India, we've been helping produce coffee with a coffee manufactured and packaged in India near to them, adding value in the local economy rather than shipping it to Europe to be processed here. All sorts of ways that we could improve the impact of fair trade. And then the scope to take fair trade into completely new products and sectors. And the example that I'm most excited about at the moment is Traidcraft's launch of a new range of household cleaning products. And this is using the first ever fairly traded palm oil sourced from small-scale farmers in Ghana. It adds social impact to environmental considerations, and it offers real scope to reduce the sourcing of palm oil from the Far Eastern rainforests. At the moment in Ghana, which was one of the original countries in which palm oil was created, 90% of the palm oil they consume comes from the Far Eastern rainforests. If we can get a more thriving palm oil industry in Ghana, then we can actually start substituting for that. I think this is really exciting to see fair trade going into something completely different and new, but actually, there's no prospect for a fair trade mark on palm oil for several years. It's got a fair trade mark because of some of the other smaller ingredients sort of in that product. We've had to, at Traidcraft, that's sort of palm oil being grown, produce our own little certification label to stress actually the palm oil here is what really matters about this product. I think it's very exciting because I think palm oil is a really key strategic commodity for us to tackle because of all of its environmental and other implications. But it's very significant that this sort of radical innovation is coming from the pioneer organisations, Traidcraft in this case. That sort of innovation isn't coming from the big companies who can't press the boundaries further forward because they don't have the credibility to do something before the fair trade mark exists. But the fair trade mark won't get created until there's a supply chain to monitor. Without the Traidcrafts, you're not going to get that sort of diversification of impact. So the role of the dedicated pioneers, people producing these sorts of products, is absolutely vital. And the shops that they sell through, like the One World shop here in Edinburgh, they really need to thrive so that these products have a market and can carry on doing all the awareness raising, the investment in pioneering that's going to be needed. I'm not saying that big company involvement is bad. We've got to have it to have impact. But we can't afford to lose these guys in the process. So for all the success that we've been celebrating, there is more to be done. The job is not over. We can't rest on our laurels. So where does Scotland and Edinburgh University potentially fit in? Well, I think you have got a vital role. Grassroots campaigners, as I've already said, who can keep the fair trade agenda focused on the things it should be on, reaching really poor, marginalised producers. we've got to keep enthusing people to want to buy fair trade and support fair trade products, because otherwise the big companies will soon disappear. And it's organisations like those in this room who are going to be able to sustain that sort of popular support. Fairtrade, I think, also will help to bring hope to communities, because as individual supporters begin to see the impact that Fairtrade's been able to have, and Fairtrade has been a grassroots up movement in the UK, it's been individuals inspired by a passion to try and change the world who have made the apparently impossible actually happen. And I think that often people in this country, we see big problems, we think, well, I've got to leave this to somebody else. It's too big, it's too complex, I can't make a difference. Actually, we can if we're prepared to get engaged. If a few people with vision could get Nestle to go fair trade, and Tesco's, and Cadbury's, and many others, then actually other impossible changes could happen too. So I think that promoting fair trade is part of promoting active citizenship, and therefore it's a really good tool to use. And finally, two specific suggestions. Within the university, could we find ways to encourage more research into the impact of fair trade? And by that, I don't just mean comparing fair trade with non-fair trade, which is what most studies tended to do, but what are the ingredients within the fair trade package which are really most important? Is it actually the price mechanisms? Or is it the long-term relationships? Is it the group formation? Is it, as I suspect, often the savings clubs that producers spontaneously form, which make a huge difference to the way they feel about themselves and their neighbours? We just don't know. We need more research so we understand how impact is best achieved. Sorry, that's a picture of Traidcraft researchers in action. And then could Fairtrade Scotland maybe pioneer a new style of fair trade product again? I think there's a great opportunity to start blending fair trade ingredients from the southern hemisphere with ingredients from marginalised farmers in the north. In Germany, the fair trade equivalent of Traidcraft, called GAPA, has started doing fair trade chocolate with cocoa and sugar from the global south, but milk from impoverished alpine farmers. So they're getting double benefit at the same time. What about our Scottish crofters? Could their milk go into fair trade chocolate? Could their oats go into fair trade cereal bars? It's going to be difficult to achieve. It would need, I think, a lot of support from the Scottish Government and from other organisations to create the wherewithal to make that happen. But wouldn't it be exciting for fair trade nation Scotland to really take forward an innovative new style of fair trade such as that? So as we mark these two anniversaries this evening, let's be thankful for all that has been achieved, for the difference fair trade's made to millions of lives around the world, for the hope and opportunities that children in many of these fair trade communities now have. But let us at the same time not be complacent. The job is not done, not by half. We've got to use fair trade as a more effective development tool so we can make an even greater difference to lives abroad and to attitudes at home. That's the only way we're going to make a difference to the challenge of global poverty. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. I hope you'll answer a few questions. We have around 5 minutes or so for questions. Who would like to open with some questions? Okay, David, about two-thirds of the way back.
Hi, my name is Juan Santelices from Fair Business Alliance. You mentioned what university could do, and very interesting suggestions. But going to a bit more into the academic bits as well, what a nation and also what university could do. What do you think about the economy of the solidarity? Like, let's say the government from France has made an agreement with the Ecuadorian government last year in all these topics. So I think, as you mentioned before, in the early stages of a presentation, fair trade as a label is not going to reduce much the 2.5 billion people living under $2. But we need to change our mentality. We need to have the Adam Smiths of the fair trade or the economy of the solidarity. What do you think about that?
Well, I think Scotland's actually a very good example, particularly its links with Malawi, which has been very prominent within fair trade activity, but also more widely, just in terms of Scottish support for development in Malawi. I know the Just Trading Initiative and the rice piles and all of that has been really very, very interesting. And I think it's very positive to develop those sorts of intentional links between countries, because again, it raises awareness. To me, fair trade is that awareness-raising tool. It's that reminder. It's so effective as a campaigning tool. If I talk to people in Oxfam and Christian Aid, as I do regularly, they just wish they had something like fair trade to really generate regular enthusiasm amongst their supporters, because they can produce a postcard campaign and then it stops until they're next asking for money for a disaster. Fair trade is there all the time, and fair trade creates that recognition of the need for a more solidarity economics generally. And I think the Scottish Malawi relationship has been quite a good example that could be built on, and there's a lot of fair trade that's going on in Malawi. Sugar, tea, handicrafts, I know, all come from Malawi. So that's something actually I'm sure the Minister will be aware of and will want to encourage.
Great, thank you. Anybody else got questions? Yes, please.
Okay, hi, my name is Ida, and I'm an MSc International Development student in the School of Social and Political Science. So just from the case studies that you were showing just before, I see that you're working with farmers that are already engaged in agriculture, but what are you as an organization doing to work with farmers that probably have a desire to engage in agriculture but are sitting on their piece of land because they don't have access to the resources that they need for farming? So in terms of capacity building, like, are you helping farmers that, you know, probably need that mechanization or access to fertilizers and that sort of stuff?
I think the last project that I described in Bangladesh isn't about fair trade. It was trying to do just that, getting to quite a lot of landless laborers involved in those projects. And we're working, quite often landless laborers will actually be working with smallholders, and it's about creating opportunities for them to organize themselves. So in the Indian sort of cotton example, there are groups of women who produce organic fertilizers that they then supply into the small farmers. So we're trying to reach out where we can then. Traidcraft, though, is a very small organization. It can't achieve everything. Its main focus is upon trading with existing small farmers who need access to markets. And I think there are other agencies who need to put in more of the work and provide the resources that will lift other people up to that first stage, because Traidcraft can only work when we've got a product that we can then sell on, which is what's funding it, because we don't raise very much from grants. So I said fair trade is not the solution to every problem, it's the solution to part of the problems, and it's good for awareness raising. So we do what we can to spread best practice ideas, but Traidcraft can't claim that it's actually achieving the sort of things you're talking about on a big scale.
Hi, Jody Lewis from One World Shop. I'm on the board of that organisation. Just a quick question about the fair trade standard and the dilution of that standard from a customer point of view is going to, you know, it's ripe for confusion and quite frankly sounds a bit stupid. Is there any way you would like to see the British government, for example, ensure that at least all fair trade products in the UK were sold with our own UK fair trade golden standard, which would ensure that customers in this country don't have any confusion?
I think there's a very good consumer protection argument, actually, and what we don't see yet is exactly what the Fairtrade Foundation is going to do, because I think they're aware of the risks as well. In terms of making sure it's a slightly different, it's a sufficiently different mark that consumers won't be misled to thinking it's the same. And my argument was put a Fairtrade mark only on the back of the product against the ingredient list, not on the main front of the product. That would start to help. I'm not sure that idea is being taken forward, but it was what I was advocating while I was still at Traidcraft a year ago. The danger we have in today's world, of course, is cross-border trading means that if the Dutch fair trade people are allowing companies to put the mark in a certain way, they can then bring it across the borders. And so I do think it's an interesting suggestion that from a consumer protection angle, there should be some negotiations going on with the Fair Trade Foundation to say, let's see what proposals you're really bringing forward here and make sure that actually they are right, because I think it is risky. I'm not saying there aren't any benefits from their strategy. I do understand what they're going for, but I am very frightened of the the medium to long-term impacts that will be had. They'll get their good growth curves from what they're doing, but they may not get the depth of impact and the long-term benefits.
Great, thank you. I think there's time for one last question, if anybody's got one. Yes.
My name is Danush Dinesh, and I'm from the Plan Vivo Foundation. And my question is with reference to before the event began, on the screen there were some messages going on what is fair trade actually. And one of the statements read, fair trade shouldn't be about promoting the fair trade brand, and it should be about promoting fairer trade. And a lot of your presentation focused on fair trade certified products. Certified by the Fairtrade Foundation and affiliated organizations. So I just wanted to ask you what alternative certification schemes exist and what do you think about these schemes and should they be promoted or not? And you know, is fair trade a monopoly? And is a monopoly a good thing? Thank you.
There are other fair trade or equivalent standards available. The World Fair Trade Organization, which tends to bring together particularly crafts producers, has been working on its equivalent standards. The problem's going to be getting consumer recognition of that sort of product. So fair trade is, I think, the fair trade mark is going to remain the dominant player in this. There's another group called IMO, which has a Fair for Life sort of mark, and there are some alternatives out there. But I think in the UK, we have something like 90% consumer recognition of the fair trade mark, and about 85% of those who recognise it trust it to really do a good job. That is just an astonishing position. So I actually think encouraging competing labels just isn't going to work against that. What we've got to really focus on is making sure it works well, but also that the real activists, the people who are passionate, understand that it's not all about the fair trade mark, and that fair trade, two words, or fairer trade, even more generally than that, is an important part of the equation. But you've got to do a bit more research then and go to the right sort of outlets if you're going to be able to know where to buy from. I just don't think we can go back from where we are now, given how popular the fair trade mark has become. So, and my concern is if the fair trade is diluted and is then discredited, that will do immense damage to the long-term future of fair trade, potentially. So I think this is a crucial turning moment this next year in the way the movement is. I hope we can get through it, but it needs everyone to be prepared to engage.
One last question there.
Could you just say a little bit about connections between fair trade and sustainability? We worked in India in the early 70s when Traidcraft was starting, and the use of water for commercial crops is becoming more and more of an issue. There are a lot of sustainability issues. Can you see ways of strengthening the connection?
Yes, and I think, again, to give credit to the fair trade mark, the criteria for fair trade products increasingly build in strong sustainability issues as well. If a product is an ingredient is going to qualify for fair trade standards, I have to say I've always had questions. And Traidcraft, so when I was there, and I don't believe has any plans, things like fair trade flours, which have big water implications. I'm not sure that we should have gone there. That's another example of big company pressure. Tesco's wants to do fair trade flours, so fair trade made it happen very quickly. I don't think it should have been a big priority. The wider sustainability agenda is vital, and a lot of producers are very concerned about what climate change is doing to them. Harvests are getting much more erratic because of changing weather patterns. And just in my 10 years at Traidcraft, the number of instances of weather going wrong noticeably increased over time. So the whole sustainability agenda and climate change agenda cannot be sort of forgotten. Again, fair trade isn't going to solve that, though. We've got some much bigger issues that needs taking on that front. Fair trade plays its part, I think, largely through the consumer awareness raising again, creating the political sort of backing for tough decisions from our political leaders who will need to take real action, I think, to tackle some of these water and pollution and fossil fuel type issues.
Thank you. And if you think of other things during the next half an hour or so, Paul will be here for a while afterwards and you'll be able to ask him questions. So thank you, Paul. Humza Yousaf is the MSP for Glasgow. Is the MSP for Glasgow and Minister for External Affairs and International Development. He's got a strong interest in fair trade and has seen its benefits in action. He's been a member of the Justice Committee, a member of the Public Audit Committee, Parliamentary Liaison Officer to the Office of the First Minister, and he's now serving under the Cabinet Secretary for Culture and External Affairs, Fiona Hislop. And she's been a real leader and supporter of fair trade and has joined a number of our events in the past. So we're absolutely delighted that you're here, Minister, and we look forward to hearing from you.
Well, it's a great pleasure, Professor. Thank you so much for that introduction. Thank you, Paul, for your talk. I really enjoyed it, and you took all the hard questions for me as well, which I really appreciate. It's a great pleasure to be here. We're celebrating, as was said, two anniversaries. The first one, of course, of Scotland achieving fair trade nation status. It's been a year, or almost a year, and Edinburgh University, of course, the first university in Scotland, the third in the UK, 10 years ago, to achieve fair trade nation status as an institution. I'm delighted to be here for that reason. I'm delighted to always be in this fantastic hall. Although I must confess, when I come to universities, I always get a bit nervous. There's two reasons for it. One is, you know, as everybody else, and many people here studied in university, and so often reminds me of those tough exam times. But I also got married in a university, my old university in Glasgow, and both events were just about as nerve-wracking as each other. So, but it's always a great pleasure to be here. I've been in the role now for a year and a half, and in terms of international development, the one thing that struck me is the amount of people and organisations that have been involved in this movement, from churches to schools to colleges to individuals in their own family, but also the length and breadth of the country of which they're involved. And Paul touched upon our links with Malawi, which I'll come back to. I remember in the first week of the job, the member of the Scottish Parliament for Orkney, Liam MacArthur, requested that I meet with him and his guest from Cholo Highlands in Malawi, Pastor Kester, who was twinned, his presbytery was twinned with a presbytery in Westry in Orkney. And it was to do with fair trade and exchange of fair trade products and so on and so forth. And here was this pastor from Malawi who had seen more of Orkney, and a bizarre situation, sitting there talking to him, telling me, "Minister, you must go to Orkney. There's this to see, that to see, that to see." And here I was being told by this pastor from Malawi what I must see. But nonetheless, it demonstrated the length and the breadth across Scotland of that relationship. For me, fair trade issues, much like actually the issues of climate change, actually, are not necessarily issues of aid or charity. And that's why obviously we use the term development, but it's more than that. I would argue it's an issue of justice, because in terms of trade, and particularly from the developing world, from the global south, we've benefited through our own industrial revolution, from the backs of the slave trade. In Glasgow, the second city of the empire, we can't deny that history whatsoever, and Scotland's role in that history. We've benefited from trade and the exploitation of trade. So therefore, this for me is not an issue of aid and charity or a handout or doing something good to make us feel good. Actually, it's an issue of justice, it's responsibility, it's an obligation that each one of us has to do, and not because we were perhaps directly implicit in those events of the past, but because we as a nation have benefited. So therefore, we must try to redress that imbalance that exists. I saw firsthand myself recently. I was in Malawi and Zambia visiting some of our projects through there, and Paul was absolutely right to mention that relationship we have with Malawi, which is incredibly important. And again, you know, always amazed at the links between Scotland and Malawi, and something that, you know, that level of trust and history that we have and goodwill with Malawi is something that I think we should never shy away from, something that we should use to the maximum good that we possibly can. The first day I arrived, the first event that I did,
second event that I did on the day, was a round table in Blantyre. The round table was about how we use trade and investment to create local jobs, create local wealth and help in development. And we held it in Blantyre in a place called Mandala House. Mandala was the name of the first European business ever to start, to ever trade in Malawi. It was actually called the African Lakes Corporation, which again some of you may know about. The African Lakes Corporation was started by two brothers from Glasgow, John and Frederick Moyer. It then became known as Mandala House because John Moyer had very thick spectacles and Chichewa spectacles as Mandala. And so they became Mandala House. And actually his other brother, just to go off on a complete tangent as politicians do, his brother had a walking stick. And so all the shops were called Kondodo, which means walking stick, which I thought was a great story. But nonetheless, the first ever company to be trading in Malawi, European company to be trading in Malawi, creating jobs, creating local wealth, was a Glaswegian company. And so as soon as you walk into Mandala House, you have a giant picture of the headquarters in Renfield Street in Glasgow, which is phenomenal. So 150 odd years ago that we were there, and yet then we seem to have pulled out. But we have a responsibility because of that history, I think, to see how we can improve the situation. What I also liked about Liz's video, it was very well made and touched upon many of the good benefits of fair trade. What I saw myself there also was what else fair trade meant. Actually, Paul touched upon this too. It didn't just mean that there was a little bit extra income. What it meant was an education for their daughters. What it meant was having a little bit more empowerment in the communities. And we saw that absolutely firsthand, whether it was projects that we visited in Lusaka and in Zambia, that SCIAF were running on sustainable agriculture, or indeed whether it was the women cooperatives and boutiques that we visited through in Lilongwe. It was inspiring to see, and what that actually meant, you don't get an idea of until I think you see it absolutely firsthand. There's 204 days till a referendum on Scottish independence. Not that I'm counting, of course, 204 days to go. And there'll be a range of views in this hall, no doubt. Some people for, some against, many, no doubt, undecided. And the one thing I always think about when it comes to the referendum is that if this debate is about any issue, then it's about what kind of Scotland we want to see on the world stage, what kind of Scotland we, what values are important to us as a nation domestically, but also internationally. That's why it gave me great pride when we launched the white paper, which I'm sure you've all diligently read all 670 pages of. One person's at least not, which I'm delighted about. But within that very important, I thought, chapter was what would Scotland do if it had the powers over international development? What would our commitments be to the rest of the world as a good global citizen? And, you know, we mentioned things about how we'd legislate for 0.7% from the first parliament. We talked about gender equality. But one of the things we discussed in there was the issue of do no harm, having a coherent policy across the government for development, you know, policy coherence in development. And trade and fair trade, I think, would be an absolute vital element of that. We don't want to undermine all the good work that we potentially could do by trading practices, be they in a multilateral institution scenario, or indeed be it by trading arms to some of the most brutal dictators the world has ever seen, which is often a criticism faced by the UK. So how can we use the policies of do no harm to further promote that agenda? But there's also, we have to look at the current powers that we have within the Scottish Parliament in the current constitutional setup too. So we have a procurement bill that's making its way through Parliament, and we're engaging quite closely with the Scottish Fair Trade Forum. I'm happy to discuss that when I take some questions, no doubt. But we're seeing how can we have a difficulty, as was mentioned by Paul, with perhaps the certification with the capital F, capital T, due to various competition rules and EU directives, but that doesn't mean that it's impossible, be it in the regulations or the procurement strategy or even examining on the face of the bill, can we do something whereby ethical trading
is there as part of the criteria for procurement moving forward. We look at the Commonwealth Games. It's been a great opportunity for ethically sourced goods, all the metal and the medals, for example, ethically sourced. Many things in the athletes' village, ethically sourced and fair traded. The towels I was being told of most recently as well. So we all have a great job to do in terms of the further promotion of fair trade. All of you are doing that work. It was a matter of immense pride when I got to make the announcement. But that announcement was really nothing to do with me, apart from the odd bar of chocolate I bought. I mean, I was weeks in the role. It's all down to you and to those who have worked and campaigned tirelessly over the months, the years, and even indeed the decades as well. So my absolute and utmost admiration for all the work you do. But that achieving that status is not the end of the journey. We keep having to reiterate. We still have to have more schools, more local authorities, more institutions and colleges, universities, and indeed the government buying more into the fair trade agenda, I think is important for us to do. I was in Perth last year, where I was seeing all the great organisations coming together for a fair trade celebration. It was a great event, which I enormously enjoyed, and was by the end of it, I was carrying candy floss and crisps and chocolate, and you know, helping to be a good global citizen has never been so tasty in my life. So, you know, we can enjoy it while we do it. So I'm not going to take up too much more time. I only want to say a few remarks. I'm more than happy to take questions. Of course, I can take questions on fair trade without reservation. I'm happy to take questions on general international development policies, migration policies. You can ask me about anything, actually, frankly. I don't mind. Quantum physics, I'm not great at, but anything above and beyond that should be absolutely fine. So thank you for your time, and I wish you continued success in Edinburgh University, and in particular, continued success in all that they do for fair trade. Thank you.
I'm sure you wouldn't want me to turn down the offer of the minister answering questions. So, who would, on anything? You did say anything.
Yeah. My officials are really nervous when I say that. But
so, who'd like to ask the minister a question?
You're not
going to be really shy.
Go
are
home.
You? Okay, good.
Hi, sorry, I work at the university for the sustainability department. I just wanted to say there seems to be a lot of emphasis on the responsibility of the individual to make the right choice and semantic debates around labelling. Paul mentioned that it was long-term thinking that would lead to sustainable solutions. So I just wanted to know, why are governments not regulating trade to ensure fair wages and justice for all, so that we essentially don't need to choose fairly traded products, but everything would ultimately be fair? Wouldn't that be the long-term solution to creating fair trade?
Yeah. Okay. George, do you want me to take one question at a time? Sure. Very, very, very good question. Paul actually would be, I think, in a good position as well to answer. Not that I suggest you do. Long-term sustainability is the magic bullet. You know, if we can crack that, we could really get somewhere. And the example I think of is Zambia. So when I was there looking at the project and studying the project in Lusaka, or just outside of Lusaka, where SCIAF, Scottish Catholic International Aid Fund, is funding or is developing through Scottish Government funding. What we saw there was farmers were really benefiting, and smallholder farmers really, really benefiting from more sustainable agriculture techniques. So essentially weaning them off the use of fertilizer and onto other farming techniques, which was increasing their yield, getting them into cooperatives, et cetera, et cetera. Anyway, the results of it were phenomenal. And that small village of a few hundred people, it was phenomenal. But the solution was to try to get the Zambian government to buy into it and say, look, you know, how can you, you can see the success. Now, how do you roll that across the country? And they said, they didn't say this. I would imagine they would say that they have a fertiliser subsidy programme, and therefore if they were to remove fertiliser subsidy, then, you know, politically that would be quite difficult for them to do. And so it's about working and having that relationship with governments and working with them to try to engage in longer term solutions. And, you know, the world doing development, those who are doing development, doing it in a smarter way. Now, if the Zambian government is getting a lot of pressure in terms of fertiliser subsidies, so they can't wean people off fertiliser, can USAID, DFID, perhaps a future Scottish government and aid fund, and other European partners in particular, can we get together and say, okay, well, we will provide the subsidy in terms of sustainable agriculture. And that way you can wean off fertiliser, we can help you to provide the funding, et cetera, et cetera. So can we do development by working with governments to improve the civic governance around development and help and assist to help to roll out projects that are working? In terms of your issue in terms of regulation of wages and so on and so forth, it's where we have a little bit of a concern from the Scottish Government regarding trade deals that are often done. Obviously in the European Union we're talking about a transatlantic trade deal, and while that no doubt will have benefit for Scotland and for UK, the more and more trade deals that are done with the developed world is going to have an impact, a huge impact on the Global South and others. So we believe that the UK should have a strong voice in that regard in order to not necessarily halt every trade deal that is taking place, but being a sense check about what we can do better, because I don't think it's within the power realistically for one member state or one country to try to regulate wages and others. I mean, you could try that if you have a very strong bilateral relationship, maybe perhaps Scotland and Malawi. We could try to work with the Malawian government because we have that relationship of trust. But it would be a lot stronger doing that through multilateral institutions like the European Union and being that sense check and being that voice. We're currently some of that is missing. So I don't know if that quite answers the number of your question, but I hope it gives a rough indicator.
Okay, great, thank you. And I think you were the next person.
Hi, my name's Paul Glynn. I'm founder of a charity called the Mondo Local Foundation. I don't know if I can actually make this into a question, maybe just share a point with you. That we're very much foot soldiers for fair trade, and we go into primary schools in our local area teaching kids about how to grow their own food and set up their own systems for producing things and teach them basically how to become in touch with their local natural environment with a view to raising their awareness about the global food situation. And it really does have a massive impact on the kids. We only set up a year ago, so we've been working with one primary school to develop a model. And as the kids leave primary 7 and go into high school, they're going to take on a role of twinning their school with a school in Malawi. And then as they get older, work on projects to get out to Malawi and help schools out there learn how to grow their own food and things as well. There's a plan in place to set up market stalls, so effectively the primary school kids become cooperative farmers, which is the model that fair trade was based on. And my point is, if we want to get the message across about fair trade so that we can drive markets and change consumer attitudes, it's very difficult to change the attitude of an adult because these things are ingrained in you between the ages of 3 and 12. So we have to get into primary schools and speak to them, and it all begins just with planting seeds and getting kids' hands dirty. It all grows from there. The kids actually develop their own ideas about it as we go on.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I think that was a great point. And maybe just to add to that, I would like to hear more about what your organisation is doing. So I'll make sure I give you my details before we leave. What's that? Oh. You know, you can Google Hamza Yusuf MSP. There's not many of Hamza Yusufs in the Parliament, so you'll be able to find all my details pretty online. But send me an email if you have to rush off, and I'd love to hear more. I think your central point was absolutely correct, and you know, I was really proud that the Scottish Government funded, and we're unique in this actually. We're funding global development education, so we're funding the 6 centres that are around Scotland that are bringing in teachers and teaching them about international development and global citizenship and, you know, issues about food sustainability. And they're then going into their classes, into their schools, into their classes, working with children about these issues, because you're spot on. I mean, changing, if you get that seed planted as young and early intervention as possible, then hopefully you'll be able to change and shift some of the attitudes. And look, I get it all the time. You know, from the moment I started this role, whenever we do something in international development, I'm going to get the Daily Mail and Daily Express crying out on why we're sending money to helping poor Africans when, you know, schools need money and are falling apart, which they're not, by the way. Schools are doing very well. They'll have those kind of arguments, and you'll get it not just in those newspapers. You'll also get it very much in the doorstep. I mean, I knock a lot of doors, as you'd imagine, and you do get people asking that question. And it's just misinformation. And so if you're able to change attitudes from a young age, I think you're saying your point's absolutely correct, then we can make a huge, huge impact. So development education is a strong part of that. And I think if Scotland had the resource and the responsibility over international development, we would be ploughing a fair bit of money into that.
Thank you. I think Michael, I think.
Fair and fairness occurs, I mean, the word combination, either fair or fairness, it's about 300 times in the document. Fair trade is not there. I'm just curious, why? Why not?
Okay.
Is it too radical, too subversive for the kind of broad coalition you're trying to bring together? But surely Scotland is claiming, I mean, you are claiming in the document that Scotland is different to the general broad trend of UK unfair, unequal, increasingly unequal economics. Fair trade would be a brilliant example of actually the very alternative you claim in other parts of the document to wish to support.
Yeah, that was a good question. And wow, I'm amazed that you calculated how many times fair and fairness was mentioned in the document. I'm going to use that statistic. Well, I'm going to check it first. Not that I don't trust you, and then I'm going to use it. What we always say about the white paper is the white paper is 670 pages long. If I was to put in everything about international development that I possibly wanted, and every other department put in everything they wanted to say about every single aspect of policy, it would be 6,070 pages long. Now, that's not to say that it shouldn't have just had a fleeting mention, which fair trade does, but the policies of do no harm very much focus on that idea of trade. I wouldn't want to give an impression for a minute that it's too radical. I think fair trade and the fact that we're a fair trade nation is something that we should build upon with independence. There's one more thing I would say really is, you know, just continue to watch the space, because everything that we've said, everything that we intend to say up until the running of the referendum, we've not said everything. You know, we still intend, of course, to produce more information on certain elements and certain policy as we tend to move closer towards the referendum, as you would expect. It'd be terrible if we said everything on November the 26th and had nothing else to say. And so, therefore, fair trade is a key, you know, something that we're very proud of, that status. And as I say, we're working in the current constitutional setup through other legislation that we where we can make an impact. But upon independence, it would be something that we would bang the drum of. But we do that. I think we do that. The best way we do that is through the do no harm principle. You know, how can we make ensure that our trading policies do no harm to international development work that we're aiming to do? So, perhaps upon reflection, because somebody else, I mean, had made that point to me when the white paper came out, and you know, upon reflection, perhaps it could have been stated a little bit stronger in the paper, but it wasn't through certainly. Any idea that it was too radical. I think we're very, very proud of the fact, as Professor Brown's been saying, that fair trade has, you know, Fiona Hislop has been very, very supportive over the years. I hope the government has shown its commitment to it, and the fact that we continue to fund the fair trade, Scottish Fair Trade Forum, I hope is evidence of that. So there's no shying away from it. I hope that gives you reassurance.
Thank you. So there's one last question, which is.
Oh, you've got a couple of hands up.
Well, yeah.
Go on.
Hi, my name is Song Zhao. I'm a student volunteer from University of Edinburgh. So my question is still along the line of Edinburgh's, Scotland's first Fairtrade University for the University of Edinburgh. I'm just wondering, is there any student involvement like can be in the upstream production of Fairtrade products in the future, or maybe perhaps they can get more involved with the education side, let's say going to school and raise awareness for the children in fair trade or general sustainability in long term. So,
was that a question more for the university? Sorry, I didn't catch the last bit.
I'm just wondering, is there any plans in the future that involve more students in the upstream production of fair trade products?
The production of?
Any fair trade product, so.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I mean, in fairness, we probably don't target students enough. Martin is here from the Fairtrade Forum, and certainly you can wave your hand around Martin. There they are. And so in terms of the plans for Fairtrade, because we have to do a lot more with students, I think we've really missed a bit of a trick with colleges, if I'm being honest with you. I think we've done decent amount of work with students in universities, but I think we've probably missed a little bit of a trick with colleges. We're doing some with schools, as was mentioned by Paul, who's now left, but we're doing a lot with schools, doing a lot with universities, and probably missing a whole section there in terms of colleges. So I think we could probably be doing a lot more. And one of the things we're quite keen to do, but the current constitutional setup, or indeed even in the future, is trying to get more government departments bought into the agenda of fair trade and also international development. And so the education portfolio, that's why we got Global Citizenship Education funded. And so bringing them closer into the international development field will be a real key priority. But I think there's probably a lot more we could do with students, particularly in the college side. So I don't know. I hope that answers your question.
Thank you. Now, this will be the last question, but again, so it's the gentleman there.
I think it was a chap at the back. It was given a microphone.
Okay, you've got one. Good.
Hi, Andreas Soteriadis from Scotland's Rural College. You mentioned before that Zambia saw the success of fair trade, and I was wondering, how did it see the success of fair trade when British companies that have been food companies that have been promoting fair trade products and belonging the British food group have been involved in massive multi-billion tax avoidance scandals in Zambia. So how does Zambia benefit from fair trade when fair trade is actually used as a way to take the attention of consumers away from these scandals?
That's a good question. I think, in terms of tax avoidance, I'm surprised actually it hadn't come up already. I think it's an important point that we need to keep hammering home about tax avoidance. We've made our stall very clear on tax avoidance in terms of Scotland, the powers that we have, but particularly with the powers that we may have come the vote in September, if it is a yes vote, what we'll do to clamp down on tax avoidance. Because again, it goes back to this element of do no harm. If you have a principle of do no harm and policy coherence across the government, you can't be doing a great work through DFID, but allowing £25 billion to effectively escape through legal tax loopholes every year in the UK, but also having UK businesses manipulate legislation and do some economic acrobatics when it comes to their own profits in other countries as well. So first off to say is that we've laid our stall very, very clear on what we would do in terms of tax avoidance, and you can see that in Scotland's future. The document and our prospectus on independence. In terms of Zambia in particular, I think, you make your point very, very well. There are those who have exploited Zambia, but what I was saying to you and what I was suggesting was that there's some good work that's being done by Scottish organisations and aid agencies. So the project I was talking about just outside of Lusaka is one, definitely, through sustainable agriculture and sustainable agricultural techniques. Is definitely one that if it was rolled out across Zambia, it could see massive success. Because you talk to those smallholder farmers and they tell you, they're getting more money coming into their pockets, which means they're able to send their children to school, get a house that is able to mitigate against the effects of climate change, et cetera, et cetera. So they're seeing those changes on the ground, and therefore if we were able to roll that out, and the Zambian government was able to roll that out across Zambia, I think you could see huge effect, huge benefit. That doesn't mean that you don't tackle the tax avoidance problem and the tax avoidance issue. I think it's not a choice over one or the other. I think where we have influence, we should be trying to do as much on that. But from a Scottish government perspective, I think we've really, really strongly nailed our colours to the mast and very strongly given indications of how we would look to clamp down on tax avoidance. In the future. The truth is, at the moment, those powers don't rest with us. So we can keep urging the UK government to do it, but really it's up to them to really take the steps forward. And in fairness to the UK government, which I'm not always fair, but in fairness to the UK government,
You know, I thought making this an issue at G20 was really, really important for them to do. So I'll end on that note.
Great.
I'll end on a nice note.
Thank you very much. And thank you for answering lots of questions so openly. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Kirsty, to give a vote of thanks.
I suppose my journey with Fairtrade started when I was very little, and my dad ran a workshop, and the first question how they started off was, what do you think the Fairtrade logo is? Is it a parrot? Is it a river with a sun? Is it a person? But that's not really what I'm here to talk to you about. What I suppose I'm going to do very briefly is just lay out what I want the next 10 years of Fairtrade to look like, and then thank you all for coming. So it's been a very enjoyable evening so far, but these 10 years have been good, but we have a lot more to go, and that's what I want to talk about. So there can be no denying that I am proud of the 10 years ago when USA voted to become fair trade and that Scotland has become a fair trade nation. However, I hope that 10 years down the line from now that we will have started to properly address the structural problems of the market instead of simply creating a small subsection of it. In 10 years' time, I don't want multinational companies with bad ethical records to be able to display the Fairtrade logo or to be considered that they're fairly trading. And I don't want Fairtrade to be used as a promotional tool for companies, but something that is integral to how they function. I don't want the smallest and most remote farmers to be pushed out because they have not quite been able to access the brand that we all think is great. In 10 years' time, I want the market to be solely comprised of goods that are fairly traded. I want the consumer nature to be redefined. I want the discourse of demand to shift so that it becomes inconceivable to purchase or use a product that hasn't been fairly traded. More than that, I want society to realise that what we purchase and consume is not the be-all and end-all. Society should be based around the needs of people and not that of profit, and the needs of fulfilling these needs of people. But we do live in a consumerist, profit-driven society, a system that allows some people to prosper, but only at the loss of others. The fair trade movement has done an excellent job of starting to highlight the inequalities society faces, but at the same time, it provides an easy opt-out from people making real changes. As Zizek describes it, fair trade allows you to buy redemption from being only a consumerist. Individual consumer choice is not going to change things. People cannot simply buy a coffee and feel like they have taken their part in tackling this structural inequality. Not only that, but in 10 years' time, I don't want companies with bad records to be able to simply pay lip service to Fairtrade by stocking small amounts of Fairtrade products. Take Topshop, for example, a high street chain well known for their unethical tax practices and some more broad tax and unethical problems, but yet they stock a small proportion of Fairtrade clothing items and then get to say that they're having good ethical practices and are dealing with Fairtrade. Despite the good work that has been happening, the majority of producers in the developing world are still disempowered. Biased trade rules, flooding of the markets, and a whole biased world trading system stops us from achieving our aims. We need people to engage with the concept and engage with why the brand of fair trade was created. Over the next 10 years, the fair trade movement needs to not really be about fair trade, but about tackling these much bigger problems. It needs to be about lobbying our governments for real changes, lobbying big businesses to readdress their practices and making everyone put people before profit. Fair trade in 10 years needs to not be about the rich stealing from the poor and giving them a little bit back in return, but needs to be about the rich and the poor being equal and about there being no rich and no poor. We've come a long way in the last 10 years, and the lives of many have been greatly improved by the work that's been ongoing. And for that, we have to thank everyone who's played a part. An amazing amount of work has gone into spreading the message, and fair trade, that is something that has to continue. But in 10 years' time, I don't want to be celebrating a fair trade fortnight, and there shouldn't be a need. I want us to be ambitious, and I want us to be more ambitious than we've been before. And not because it makes ourselves feel better, but because it's a necessity. We need to stop talking, and we need to stop focusing on individual consumer choices, but think about the bigger picture. While we sit here and we celebrate our successes, and rightly, because there have been successes, we also have to remember that there are still millions who are being exploited and living in poverty. And we need to restructure the market so that it is impossible for any products to not be fairly traded. And that's my vision of what I want for the next 10 years. But I'm sure that you all have maybe slightly different and other ones. And we'd invite you all and love it if on your bunting you could start to talk about what you think Fairtrade is about, where you'd like it to go, so that we can talk about them. So I'd like to thank you all very much for coming tonight. We'll all be around if you wish to talk to us, and thank you again.
This production is brought to you by the University of Edinburgh.